All right, this is not an advertisement. I suspect all of these are out of print anyway. But I just wanted to let you know this is some background material on the larger field. About 20 years ago, I wrote a commentary on the Gospel of John, which was published by somebody. didn't say on the front there. And then Meet God Again for the First Time was a book about how themes develop through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And here I developed a thesis, we'll only mention in passing today, that God's actions are repeatable and that creation, flood, and Exodus are almost identical stories, even though they're each different. They're built on each other. And there's a relationship there that's significant. And that will be a piece of what we cover today. And then 2004, the Sabbath School Quarterly on the Gospel of John was mine. And people have often asked how much of yours got in there. And I had to say about 99%. I don't know if they were intimidated by Greek and Hebrew or anything, but they kind of left it alone, for which I was grateful. And then along with that, there was a book called John, the Beloved Gospel. That was just sort of a commentary for lay people. Anyway, I don't know if these are even available anymore, but that's the background of why I was invited to write an article on creation in the Gospel of John for a forthcoming book on creation in the New Testament. So it's going to have chapters on different parts of the New Testament. So, creation in the Gospel of John. What I want to do, I'm not entirely familiar with your format here, but what I'd like to do is present the portion of the paper that I think is relevant for this class interest, and then leave it open for conversation. Now, the first thing I discovered when I took up this topic, there are thousands of pieces of scholarly, refereed, peer-reviewed literature on the Gospel of John. It's one of the most heavily studied topics, I think, in all of scientific study. And I mean that scientific in the broad sense. Biblical scholarship can be quite scientific in its approach to the text. But there was a lack of scholarly literature on creation in the Gospel of John. There were five or six pieces directly on the subject, but they were fairly short, fairly minimal. There was one dissertation which was not super helpful. Not one piece out of thousands of pieces on the Gospel of John addresses the issue of origins in relation to the Gospel. So it's just a general consensus that when John talks about creation, he's using it for spiritual purposes with no interest in scientific or origins issues whatsoever. As I pursued my own study, I began to develop a thesis that maybe he did, and nobody had noticed it yet. It's always dangerous to draw that kind of conclusion, but I thought I would pursue it and see what I could come up with. The paper itself has the following parts, not all of which we will look at this morning. First of all, review the literature and identify what are the texts, when people do address the subject, what are the texts that they talk about? All right. The second part is talking about the concept of a new creation already before John, Old Testament, Jewish writings, etc. Is there anybody else doing with creation what John typically does? And then the third part of the paper exegetes the key texts. We're only going to do one of those this morning, just as an illustration of how normally John uses creation in a spiritual sense. and then summarize his theology of creation, and then get into my unique theory. And I'm calling it here John's subtle apocalyptic. In other words, John's generally felt not to care anything about end time, apocalyptic, or whatever. And I've discovered that one ought to differ with that conclusion, and that that has implications for the science of origins that might be helpful in the context of this class. All right? So the key texts, and they were sent to you earlier this week if you're part of the list for this class. The prologue, that's probably the obvious one because it says at one point all things were made by him. That's kind of obviously a reference to creation. Then there's John 20:22, which scholars feel alludes to Genesis 2:7, because in the upper room, after the crucifixion, after the resurrection, Jesus comes into the upper room and he breathes on his disciples and says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now, off the surface, that wouldn't seem like much, but when you go to Genesis 2:7, God breathes into this dirt form the breath of life. And the words for breathe and breath are the same words as John. The word for spirit, Holy Spirit, etc., is the same word as wind and breath. That's true in Hebrew and in Greek. So when it says in Genesis 1:2 that the Spirit of God moved on the waters, it could be breath, it could be wind, it could be spirit. And the same word has all three meanings and can mean one or the other in different contexts. Sure, Paul.
True in Hebrew also?
Hebrew and Greek, yes, both of them. Yeah, pneuma is the Greek word for spirit, breath, wind. So when in John 3:8, it says, "The wind blows wherever it will. No one knows where it's coming from or where it's going. So is everyone who is born of the wind." Spirit, yeah. I, you know, it is wind and spirit. You can see that that's the intention, but it's the same word. And it's like, boom. It's a play. It's a joke almost in the Greek language. So in John 20:22, Jesus is deliberately alluding to creation when he breathes on the disciples and says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." So what happened to Adam in the original creation becomes the model for what Jesus does with his disciples. Related to that, but not mentioned as much by scholars, is John 19:28-30, where Jesus on the cross says, "It is finished." And it also says in two verses before, the scriptures were finished, where they said he would do this and this. So you have the language of Genesis 2:1-3, where God finished all of his creation and rested on the seventh day. So that is alluded to at the cross. And it talks about God's works of creation, and then throughout John it talks about Jesus' works. So anyway, I'm telling you more than I intended to, but that's very interesting stuff when you get into the scholarship. Then John 5:9 are two healings of Jesus that occur on the Sabbath. And scholars are, at least some scholars are pretty united that this is a reference to creation too. Because in the beginning of the gospel, Jesus says, light and life were made through the word. And in chapter 5, Jesus gives life to a paralyzed man at the pool of Bethesda on the Sabbath. And in chapter 9, he brings light when he heals the blind man at the pool of Siloam. So you have water, you have light and life, you have Sabbath. That combination echoing the language of creation. And then finally, people have a bunch of ideas about the days of creation. Can you find the 7 days of creation and the seven miracles? Jesus doesn't do 8 miracles or 6. He does 7 in the Gospel of John. Other Gospels, much more. So can you take those 7 miracles? Does each one of those correspond to a day? Or there's 7 days from John 1:19 to chapter 2, verse 11, and on the last day there's a wedding. So is that the 6th day or the 7th day of creation, you know, where that occurred, you know, the wedding celebration? So I think those two have some plausibility. And then there's other ideas that one person puts out and nobody follows, and we don't have to worry about them. All right. So let's get down to the core presentation. Building on the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, creation language tends to be literal toward the beginning and more spiritual as you go through. That's a trend through the Old Testament. The earlier writings tend to be more, you know, God made this and he created rocks and mountains and fish and animals and so on. Very tangible, very literal, very realistic. But as you go through, it becomes more spiritual. And we will see this, that the Exodus story is told in the language of creation, but now it's not literal the way Genesis 1 seems to be. So there's a use of creation language to say other things as you go more and more through the Old Testament. So you could say the later writings of the Old Testament spiritualize the more literal way these same terms are used ahead of time. And you can see that not just on creation, all kinds of topics. That's what this book was all about, just showing how salvation images move through the Bible from section to section. All right, let's look at a serious example. Okay, Exodus 14, 21 to 22. When you've already seen the language of creation, and then you go to the flood, you discover in the flood, it's an undoing of creation. In creation, God separates the waters below from the waters above. In separates the sea from the dry land. What happens in the flood? The rains come down and the floods come up. The two that were separated are united again. The dry land and the sea become one giant sea again. And the earth is restored to its original condition of a water-covered planet. So the flood is a deliberate reversal of creation, the very same words being used, and then a rebuilding of creation. And the flood story, taking it on its face, appears to be pretty much a replay of the creation story in a very literal historical fashion. But then you get to the Exodus, the same thing happens. Same language being used, but there's a difference this time. Where both creation and flood have a water-covered world, what do you have in the Exodus? A water-covered sea. It's not the world now. It's a much smaller scale kind of thing. And the chaos, the lack of shape that the whole world had is now seen in the slavery of Israel to Egypt. So there's a spiritualizing, if you wish, of what had been more historical, more literal before, now is used for spiritual purposes. Deliverance from slavery is a new creation. So let's take a look at the language here. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. This is the Red Sea. Notice the word Hayam. You find it in Genesis 1. You find it in Genesis 9. That's creation and flood stories. Now you find it here. He stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with what? A strong east wind. Ruach in the Hebrew. Genesis 1. Genesis 8. So it's picking up the language of these previous two stories. Turned it into dry land. The waters were divided. Again, Genesis 1, Genesis 7. And the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground. Now this word yabash, there's like four words in Hebrew for ground, for dirt. One of them is Adam. So Adam was the dirt man. You see? And Moses is a man of the soil, Adama. So right there already, you're having these connections back and forth between these stories. It's the way the Hebrew mind works. And if you want to understand the Bible, the more you can understand that Hebrew mind, the more interesting it becomes. So that it chooses Yabash here to describe the sea without the water in it is striking. Where did I come up with this stuff? Very simple. Just reading the Hebrew. And I did not know these things until I read the Hebrew. And as I was working through the flood story after doing Genesis 1 to 5, it suddenly hit me. I've heard all this before. This is the same language. And it didn't need to be. It's a different story. It could have been very different language. But the way the words were used, you felt it before you saw it. And same with the Exodus. You read the Exodus story, it's like, I've seen this before. Something's going on. So there's a repetition going on. And so in Exodus, the Exodus story is a retelling of creation, but in a more local situation, in a more spiritual way. Perhaps a little bit more on the surface is Isaiah 48 and verses 13 and 15. And here you can see again that already in the Old Testament, the spiritualizing of creation is taking place. My own hand laid the foundations of the earth. My right hand spread out the heavens. When I summon them, they all stand up together. What's that? Creation language. Talking about the past, what God did when he laid the foundations of the earth. So you have that, that becomes the model. But then notice what he says in verse 14. Come together, all of you, and listen. Which of the idols has foretold these things? The Lord's chosen ally, Cyrus, will carry out his purpose against Babylon. His arm will be against the Babylonians. So here you see creation language applied to a local historical situation. What God does in anointing Cyrus and sending him against the Babylonians is an act of creation. Through Cyrus, he will deliver his people, and their spiritual foundation will be rebuilt. So it's an act of creation. Verse 15, I have spoken. Yes, I have called him. I will bring him, and he will succeed in his mission. Cyrus is not named in this text, but if you go back to chapter 45, verses 1 to 4, Cyrus is named by name as the Messiah. It's a Hebrew word, Mashiach. Occurs only twice for a future deliverer in the Bible, in the Old Testament. And in Isaiah 45, it's referring to a pagan king. It's fascinating stuff. So God calls this pagan king to do a spiritual purpose for him with creation-like implications. So that's the Old Testament, just a couple examples in the Old Testament. Between the Testaments, you have lots of literature that picks up on the Old Testament. One of my favorites is the story of Joseph and Asenath. If you're familiar with Genesis, you'll know that Joseph married an Egyptian princess named Asenath. And it isn't clear entirely. I just discovered they didn't open the pocket on this. I know you asked them to, but anyway, I'm trying to. Okay, new suit, still need access. Okay, anyway, Joseph Asenath was the Egyptian princess that he married. All right, and in the Jewish literature, elaborating on that story, which only takes a verse in Genesis, It tells the whole story of her conversion. And the interesting thing about it, in other words, she converts to the God of Israel before he will marry her. And in the story of Joseph and Asenath, the theology is that the Jews, only the Jews, have the image of God. Remember in Genesis 1, God created all human beings in his image? But if you weren't Jewish, the image of God didn't really apply to you. You were incomplete creation. So Gentiles were incomplete creations. That probably applies to most of you, okay? And me. All right, my mom did work at a Jewish pharmacy back in the 1930s in Berlin, but she herself was not Jewish. So most of us would be incomplete creations until we convert. That's the idea. And so when Asenath converted, she attained the image of God. God's creation was completed in her. So there you see kind of a spiritual use of the creation concepts in that novel, I guess it's sometimes called. All right, let's do an example from John now to show you how John does the same thing with creation. And this is what the scholarship will teach you. I'm not giving you anything new here, but simply what I think John scholars would generally say is familiar. John 1, 1 to 4. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. I should probably stop and say, do you have any questions about what I covered? I covered a bit of a fire hose there, but I covered a whole set of biblical scholarly ideas that may not be familiar to all of you. Yes?
The reference for the story of Joseph and Asenath.
Uh-huh. Okay. You'd like to know where you could read the story of Joseph and Asenath?
Yes, I'd like that.
I would say if you, just Google that, you'll probably find online versions very easily. The standard scholarly translation is by Charles Worth. The name is Charles Worth, C-H-R-A-R-L-E-S-W-O-R-T-H. Charles Worth's Old Testament pseudepigrapha with a P. Pseudepigrapha with a P. P-S-E-U-D-E, et cetera. I'll spell it out for you later.
Okay.
So we don't keep everyone waiting, but Charles Worth's Old Testament pseudepigrapha is the standard scholarly translation. There are others, 20 volume and so forth, but you can find in volume 2 of his, you'll find Joseph and Asenath. Fun story, and well worth reading. Somebody told me, I don't know if this is true, somebody told me this week that Ellen White said you should read the Apocrypha. I know that she did read it when she was younger because there's a lot of allusions to it in early writings. She seems to take it less seriously later in her life. But it gives a window into what Jews were thinking when the New Testament was written and a background to some of those ideas. Any other? Yeah?
How far back does that story go?
Joseph and Asenath seems to be about 200 B.C., couple hundred years before the New Testament. So it's there. Whether Jesus or Paul read it, we don't have specific evidence one way or the other. But it was done in Egypt and therefore may not have been known in Palestine at the time of Jesus. Yeah?
The reference to Joseph marrying Asenath is in Genesis.
Yes, that's correct. And so what you have here, volume 2 of Charles Worth's pseudepigrapha is elaborations on the Old Testament. And you have the testaments of the 12 patriarchs. And you have all kinds of retellings of the Old Testament story with elaboration. Yeah.
It's open to question, though, whether those elaborations are factual.
Correct.
Or whether they are fantastical.
You are correct. Absolutely correct. Yeah. And scholars debate that those questions. Absolutely. Yeah, because we don't have any data earlier than that on which to test it. These are perhaps imaginary retellings, or they may reflect some oral tradition that was passed down from generation to generation. Hard to sort that out. That's why some people have tenured professorships. You know, so. Okay. Just saying. You know, somebody's got to do it, right? Okay. In the beginning, in the Greek language, that's en arche. We know arche from archaeology, the study of old things. So in the beginning, in olden days, starts the Gospel of John. If you know the Greek Old Testament, and the so-called Septuagint was translated around the time of Joseph and Asenath, Egypt was Greek at that time. The ancient Egyptian culture had been kind of set aside, although the Greeks were impressed with it, and they even built temples that looked just like Egyptian temples. But the Greek language and culture had taken over Egypt at that time. And so the Bible was translated from Hebrew into Greek so that people could have access to it in their daily lives. So if you go to the Greek Old Testament, the first two words are en arche. So here you have a hint, at least, that John is thinking of Genesis 1 as he writes the opening of his gospel. In the beginning. Now in Genesis 1:1 it says, and everyone here knows this, in the beginning God created. Here it says, in the beginning was the Word. And ultimately it becomes clear that the Word is Jesus Christ as you go through through the prologue. But here at the beginning it is simply left that. In the Old Testament, God is not called the Word. He speaks the Word. So Psalm 33, you know, by the Word of the Lord. In the Greek, it's the same word, logos. By the word of the Lord, the heavens and the earth were made, all the hosts of them by the breath of his mouth, etc. Nowhere in the Old Testament is there a personified word like you have here. God speaks, but it's not, the word is not personified. That is something that happened in Greece with the Greek philosophers. Plato talks about the logos as a second god, a mediator between God and the human race. The Egyptian Philo talks about the logos as the high priest of the heavenly sanctuary, as the one who gave the commandments on Mount Sinai. So you can see that Greek Christians might see this logos as connected to Jesus in some way. Paul?
Don't you also see in the Old Testament the word of the Lord came to the prophet so-and-so?
Right. Absolutely, yeah. So in the Old Testament, the word of God is God's speech. But here, it's not God's speech. Here, the word is a person. That's the difference.
But there, at the same time, you see wisdom used in a very similar way.
Correct.
In Proverbs.
Yeah, you do have a personified creator figure in Proverbs chapter 8 called Chokmah, which is Hebrew for wisdom, Sophia, if you're used to the Greek, you know that term. So there is a personified aid in creation, but it's not Logos, it's Sophia. Female, by the way, for those who like that idea. So here, John is doing something that hasn't happened before within Judaism. All right? When he says that there is a person named Logos who was there in the beginning, who was involved in creation, that is a new thing. And if you pull in from some of the Greek philosophical strands, it's set up for this kind of a move. In the beginning was the Word. So that's kind of the equivalent of Genesis 1, where it says, and God said. So here's another hint of Genesis 1. But the clincher is verse 3. Through him, all things were made. Through him, all things were made. So clearly this Logos, whoever it is, eventually, definitely Jesus Christ, but whoever he is at this point, this Logos is the one who made everything. In fact, there's not a single thing made that was not made by him. So this is the creator, is the Logos. On another occasion, or if we had time, we could talk about the meaning, you know, the deity of Christ, and how this text is the strongest affirmation of that. But you just have to see that in passing as we go through. Clearly, John is not quoting Genesis 1. But this only makes sense in the light of Genesis 1. And the ultimate clincher is the next part. Through him all things were made. All things were made. Now there's three words for creation in the Greek. The first one, it's katizo, it won't be on the test, don't worry about it. But that first word does not appear in Genesis 1. The main word for creation in the Greek language does not appear in Genesis 1. Instead, Genesis 1 uses poieo, which means to do something, and it uses ginomai, which means to become. Something comes to be. All right? Ginomai, especially, is not a normal word for creation in the Greek language. It's simply the word become. We use it all the time. But it's in Genesis 1, over and over and over again. If John had used katizo here, which Paul does frequently, if he'd have used the Greek word for create, we might be a little less sure that he's talking about Genesis 1. But when he uses ginomai, not once, but three times, without him nothing was made that has been made. Three times in this verse, he uses this unique word that's all over Genesis 1. You see how scholars wrestle with the issue, what was in the author's mind as he wrote this? At this point, can you doubt that Genesis 1 is in mind in John 1:1? I don't think there's any doubt in the world of scholarship. Once you've taken a look at all of this detail, in the beginning, the word, everything was made by him, and that word made is a uniquely Genesis 1 use of creation. Altogether, that's pretty convincing. One other observation, and I turned that into red, all things were made by him. What does that mean? All things. All things on earth, the whole galaxy, the whole universe. It's the Greek word panta, which the German translation for it is das All. It means the everything. And in German, das All is outer space. So the everything means the universe. And you can demonstrate that because in verse 10, he talks about the world, which is the word cosmos. For us, cosmos is the universe. For the Greeks, it's the world, in contrast to the universe, which is panta, the everything. So the earth is part of the everything. So, just file this away for now, but Genesis, John 1:3 is talking about the creation not just of this world, but of the entire universe. And then he localizes it later on in the same lengthy paragraph. All right, one more observation. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. Two more crucial words, life and light. Very crucial to creation. I even should have included verse 5 where it talks about darkness, because darkness is a piece of the creation as well. So John 1, 1 to 5, definitely an allusion to creation. So what does John do with it? What does he do with Genesis 1 in John 1? He affirms it as what? Okay. I would say he affirms it by implication. Okay, he doesn't say. He's quoting Genesis 1 as he goes through. We'll talk about the implications for creation science at the close. But notice verse 12. Notice what he's doing with it. John 1:12, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. There's that word again, egeneto in the Greek, from ginomai. If any of you have that background, you'll recognize what I'm saying. But he gave the right to become children of God. That's why this is so fascinating. Because Genesis has this unique usage of ginomai. John picks up on it, but now he shifts it. What is being created here? Children of God. In the beginning, God created the image of God, but now he's creating children of God. And it's using the language of creation. If you read this simply in the English, you'd never see this. Because in translation, it wouldn't be the same word. But when you look at it in the original, you see that there's a pattern here of ginomai that's really critical. Happens again in verse 14. The word became flesh. In verse 3, everything that came to be through him. Now it says, the word himself came to be flesh. So what is created here? The flesh of Jesus Christ. Jesus is a created being in his humanity. Our pioneers debated on whether that applied to his divinity or not, and that's, I would say no. But here, his humanity, his fleshliness came to be. It was created at his birth. The Word is part of God's creation. And this is very significant because Adam was created, the flesh of Jesus was created, and then later on Lazarus, what happens with him? Comes out of the grave. Just file it away. This I think is leading us somewhere. Very interesting. One more. The word appears again in verse 17. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. So what was created in verse 17? Grace and truth. So you see that John is taking the language of Genesis, the literal language, and using it for a spiritual purpose. Yes?
One of the things that John is establishing here is that this word is the source of life. And as the source of life, he can make his own body. He wasn't created by some other being, necessarily. Mm-hmm. And so here when it says, the truth came through, when you combine the two words, came through, it's a revelation. Mm-hmm. Not that it started here, but it's a revelation of Jesus and the nature of Jesus.
And he uses creation language to talk about that.
Exactly.
Yeah. So this is where scholarship has said, and maybe I have a summary statement of that, so let me just put that on the screen. The physical categories of Genesis 1 have become the spiritual dimensions of John 1. So that's kind of a summary statement of the consensus of biblical scholarship on creation in the Gospel of John. Paul?
I raised the question, is this really only in John brand new, or do we see hints of it, for example, in Jeremiah, where he says, I will create a new heart and a new spirit?
Absolutely. I only gave a couple examples, but the Old Testament, I think in the paper there are at least a dozen examples, and there could be more. I wrestled with several and decided not to include them, like Ezekiel 36, where it talks about taking out the heart of stone and giving you a heart of flesh and things like that. There's so many places in the prophets where creation language is used, but it's talking about not the original creation, not the end time. It's talking about something right in front of them. Isaiah 65, 17, I create a new heavens and a new earth. And then he goes on to describe the restoration of Jerusalem that would happen after the captivity to Babylon. That's taking the mighty creation language, but applying it to a very local situation. So what John is doing is no surprise. He does it better than anyone else in the New Testament, but he's following a tradition in which that was being done, which of course leads the scholars to suggest, you know, one possible interpretation of that is, well, if that's the way first century Jews use creation, then let's not read anything more into it. And that's sort of where that comes. But I don't think you would be happy to leave it there, so we won't. Can you say more? Is there something you can say about origins on the basis of the Gospel of John? And my answer is yes, because of John's apocalyptic. And this goes really against the grain of scholarship, or some scholarship at least. I think you mentioned it, sister. I've got it on the screen now. John's spiritual argument implies a real creation. In other words, if God is going to be useful spiritually, it would be helpful if he already demonstrated his power to change things. Yeah. So I agree with you that John's spiritual argument doesn't undermine creation. It simply assumes it. And if creation were, what did you say earlier, fantasy or, no, you had a really good word.
Well, about fantastical.
Fantastical, yeah. If it's just fantastical, of course, but John does not seem to take that position, but I think we can do more than just imply, and that's where I'm heading. All right. Bultmann, one of the most famous skeptics of the historicity of the New Testament, and therefore Paul was among those that said, oh, put him in. You got to put Bultmann in if he says something good. So Bultmann says in his commentary on John in German, and yes, I unfortunately had to learn German to do this kind of work, but everything without exception was created by the Logos. In other words, Bultmann's, while he himself is skeptical of whether John's telling a true story about Jesus, he's very straightforward in saying John believed that creation was real. Okay, the implication of his use of creation shows that he believed in it. Now, for those of us who believe, his belief is important. That's significant. Bultmann also goes on to say that John assumes the what of creation, but doesn't tell us the how or the why. And I think that's obvious. He has not gotten into how God created or when God created or why God created, but John does assume that God is the creator and that everything that we experience was the result of his work. All right. An issue for what I'm about to do is a man named C.H. Dodd, who is one of the most respected New Testament scholars by me. I mean, this C.H. Dodd is amazing. And he came up about 60, 70 years ago, came up with stuff that has revolutionized how we look at the New Testament. He makes the observation that the Gospel of John is totally disinterested in the end time, in eschatology. And at least on the surface, he's absolutely right. It's stunning. Jesus stands on the Mount of Olives and describes prophecies of the future in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Gone. It's not there in the Gospel of John. John not only uses the language of creation, he uses the language of the end time for immediate spiritual purposes. So Dodd coined the term realized eschatology. He says, for the Gospel of John, the end has already come. And what God promised to the prophets has now been fulfilled in the person of Jesus and in the experience of his disciples. So we have a real, present heaven, a real, present eschaton. And he's right. Don does exactly that. Where I would differ with Dodd is to say that that's the only perspective on eschatology that matters. I mean, you could come to that and say, well, there is no future. There is no end time. Is John saying that? Is he saying everything that matters has already happened? In the coming of Jesus, it's all good. So just a sec. So the end time focus is essentially absent in the Gospel of John. And that's true. And scholars have widely known, Adventist scholars as well, have come to realize, yeah, Gospel of John is doing something very different with end time than the book of Revelation or Luke or so on. Yeah.
So when Jesus said it is finished, was he referring to what Dodd is saying?
Well, he's quoting Genesis 2. Just as the original creation was finished, now the new creation, this new spiritual creation, is finished. So that all fits into what Dodd is saying. Yeah.
This is the same John that wrote Revelation.
Well, that, of course, is something that goes a step beyond what the Bible actually says. Most early church fathers believed that it was the same person. A couple of them said there were two Johns in Ephesus, John the disciple and John the elder, and that it was the elder who wrote it rather than the disciple. People noticed that the Gospel of John is beautiful Greek. The book of Revelation is fifth grade Greek. You have school texts from ancient Egypt, fifth graders writing Greek about making the mistakes that Revelation has grammatical mistakes, hand over fist. John does not. So people look at that and they say, it must have been two different people. My theory, for what it's worth, since you're not paying for it, not much. But my theory is that on Patmos, he didn't have his secretary. When you read the manuscripts of Ellen White, she needed a secretary. Desperately, yeah. So inspiration does not make a person a literary giant. But evidently John's secretary was pretty awesome, because in the Gospel of John is beautiful Greek. Yeah.
I will have to ask, what do these people do with John 6:54?
Uh-huh.
The one eating my flesh and drinking my blood has life eternal, and I will Anastaso, raise him up, unto eskate himera, in the last day.
Right.
If you can't get eschatology out of that, I'm not sure.
There are four or five of those phrases, and what those who are settled against an eschatology for John, they would say those were interpolated by a later editor. That's what Bultmann would say, for example. These were interpolated by a later editor. Yeah.
Yeah, the only problem with that is that there's no manuscript evidence for that. This is vaporware.
It is. That is true. On the other hand, if we didn't have all the evidence we had for Ellen White, those kinds of things would go by us as well. But we recognize that Great Controversy has 7 editions, starting with early writings and so on. And each of them is different. Some of them have Sunday laws and some of them don't. Oops, did I scare anyone? Just pointing out that if you just look at the evidence, this is a scientific class, so I trust you don't mind, we just talk about the evidence. When you read the testimonies, she doesn't talk about science, history, prophecy, or exegesis. It's in the books that were most heavily edited by others that these things were brought in. So that it's just a piece that one has to keep in mind when you're looking at her. If you simply take it that every word came directly off her pen, that isn't the case. And so yeah, I think that there's no question that her inspiration shines through at every place, and her main themes are absolutely sound. But when people say she made this mistake, that mistake, the other mistake, maybe it's because we're expecting something from her that wasn't what actually happened. So anyway, that's a sidetrack, and we're going to miss the reason I came today. So let me try to leave a little bit of time for questions. So, John's apocalyptic. Even if those were interpolations, Paul. So, okay, let's grant Bultmann that much. All right? I'm not going to touch those. Not even going to talk about them. I think there's other evidence that is much more subtle and therefore would not likely be inserted by a contrary editor later on. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood or overcome it. All right? First of all things were made. I pointed that out earlier. In the introduction to the prologue, John has a cosmic perspective. That's apocalyptic. Apocalyptic has a cosmic perspective in our use of the word cosmic, not the Greek one. All right? So John clearly has a bigger picture than just this earth. Whatever he's doing, it's big. All right? So you contrast. In verse 10, he uses cosmos to talk about the planet. So this is something bigger than just the planet. So right there, there's a hint of apocalyptic. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light of men is a limited perspective. But the life that he gave to humanity is only a portion of the life that he has. The light that he gave to human beings is only a portion of the light that he has. This is something bigger in view. Now we get to an interesting one. The darkness, the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it, some translators say. Other translators say has not overcome it, which is the truth. The Greek word here is the word for grasp, to grasp something. You can grasp something with the hand, all right? If I wanted to get aggressive with Paul, I could grasp and shake. You see, that would be an aggressive action. But you can grasp with the mind. Do you see how both of these translations come out of the same word? The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it or not overcome it. Which do you think is more likely here? Okay, I believe, and the most recent translations agree, that overcome is the better translation. The darkness is trying to grasp the light with the hand. It's aggressive. It's hostile. but it's failed. It did not succeed in its mission to overcome the light. What does that remind you of? Cosmic conflict. In the beginning, there was light, and darkness attempted to seize it, to overturn it, to overcome it, and failed. So you have a hint here, I think, of the cosmic conflict. Keep in mind, this is different from Genesis. We'll get to you in a minute, Danilo. But in Genesis, there's darkness and light. But is the darkness a hostile power in Genesis? No, it's not. It's simply there. And God doesn't conquer it. He packages it into the creation. So here John is disrupting a little bit the Genesis story to make it make his own point. He goes back beyond Genesis 1 to the war in heaven. Book of Revelation is full of it. Gospel of John has not been recognized to have so much. If John of the Gospel and Revelation is the same person, my argument is even stronger. But I think you can make the case either way that this author is definitely aware of that cosmic story of good against evil, light against darkness. Apocalyptic is dualistic. Good against evil, light against darkness. John opens up with subtle apocalyptic at the beginning of his gospel. One little side piece. Biblical dualism is always temporary. For the Persians, the light against darkness is an eternal battle. They've always been there. They'll always be fighting. We'll always be in this mess. But the biblical dualism is a temporary one. It began at a certain point in heaven. It will end. So by bringing it in here, John is already saying, this is not a permanent situation. There is a future. Something is different. Poor C.H. Dodd is not alive. You know, I'd love to talk to him about this. And I think he wrote commentaries on John, too. It would be a wonderful discussion. But I see here hints, at least, of this cosmic perspective that he felt was not there. Let's see, one or both of you had a question? Done. Well, but you can move back. What's happened, you know, is fair game.
I think that in a large sense, in addition to overcome, also the understood is also essentially essential component of it, because the whole point of darkness is that it doesn't have the grasp of what it's dealing with. If something is in darkness, it means it's unclear.
Doesn't get it.
It's muddy. Yeah. It's opaque. It's understood. Mm-hmm. It's not even available for understanding. Mm-hmm. So there is no way to marry that with light and clarity and focus and appreciation for what's going on.
What supports your perspective there is that clearly when Jesus comes as the light in verses 9 to 11, which we didn't look at here, when he comes as the light, he is resisted.
Yes.
And so the idea of understanding packages with that resistance. John 1:11, his own did not receive him. Their lack of reception is combined with understanding. But I think understanding alone doesn't give us the full picture of what is happening here. All right. So the earthly conflict in John 1:11 is rooted in the cosmic conflict. And just so you know, I'm not the only person that's ever seen this. There are several scholars of top rank who have dabbled with John 1:5 and said, you know, there's something more going on here. And that's why recent translations have gone to the overcome interpretation. So this is not so much a solo operation as picking the best insights on several of these texts and putting them together in a way that maybe hasn't happened before. The most apocalyptic text in the Gospel of John, and the one that forced Bultmann to say the whole thing, is interpolated. You know, it's one thing to have a recurring phrase. You could easily see somebody inserting that here and there just to make a point. But this fits so seamlessly into chapter 5. You know, read the whole chapter when you get a chance. You can see this fits into the whole argument of the chapter. It's kind of hard to say this three-verse chunk just suddenly appeared magically and nobody noticed. So, for as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. If we had an hour just for John 5, you would see that just prior to this, Jesus uses the same words, but he's clearly talking present tense. Anyone who believes me, present tense, has, present tense, eternal life. So eternal life for John is a present concept. But in these verses, he shifts gears and moves into the future. The only place in the gospel, substantively, that he does this. And he says that he has given the Son authority to judge, verse 27, because he is the Son of Man. Any Old Testament text you would bring in here? Not Genesis 1 this time. Daniel 7, absolutely, that's right. Where the Son of Man comes into the judgment. So that's an apocalyptic text, if there ever was one. If you want to say, what is apocalyptic, go to Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. And even the greatest skeptical scholars all say, Daniel 7's the model for whatever apocalyptic is in the ancient world. John here is bringing in Daniel 7 in an apocalyptic fashion, talking about the future judgment. Judgment here is a future concept. It's present tense elsewhere in the gospel, but here it's a future. Three verses earlier, he says the person who has eternal life has already passed through the judgment. So judgment there is present and past tense, but here it's future. Verse 28, I'm sorry if this is fire hose, but I'm watching the clock. Oh, boy. Anyway, so Jesus is an apocalyptic figure here. And he goes on to say, do not be amazed at this. A time is coming, future, when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live. Those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. So the same person who creates life from the dirt can bring life out of the ground at the resurrection. John 8:44. I'm going to have to go quickly here. John 8:44, you belong to your father, the devil. You want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning. That's creation language. From the beginning, not holding to the truth. There's no truth in him. So here in John 8 is another echo of the cosmic conflict. And then John 12:31. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. That's Satan. So here's another reference to the cosmic conflict. All right, summing up, what's my contribution to the scholarship on creation in the Gospel of John? First of all, for John, salvation is both present and future. He does have a future concept. Most of the time, he uses eschatological language as already happening in Jesus. But there are places where he points to the future as well. For John, creation power fuels both the miracles of Jesus and the destruction of death at the end of time. So both the present actions are creative power and the future actions are creation power. While the present salvation is spiritual, The future salvation must be real in order to matter. See, I'm okay with spiritualizing creation the way John does, because I just love the way God's power can transform my life and the life of people that I work with. I've seen it, I've experienced it, it happens. And to think of that as a creation act, wow, that, you know, when I decide to forgive somebody who's unforgivable, that's creation power. You know, that's a miracle that happened, even though nobody else would notice. That present salvation is spiritual, but the future salvation needs to be real, or we're stuck in this mess for eternity. So that's, you know, when you talk in the future, there's the presumption it's got to be real. For John, the future salvation has to be real if it's going to matter. There is a new heaven, a new earth. There is a new body and things like that. John's view of the end, therefore, clarifies his view of the beginning. You could simply say, well, John spiritualizes creation, and therefore that's all that really matters. It's you know, the spiritual side of God is all that he's really affirming there. He's not talking about bricks and rocks and sea and stuff like that. It's a metaphor for God's salvation then and now. But when you realize that John has a tangible future, you can no longer read his creation stuff that way. That future depends on the reality of the creation at the beginning. For John, the defeat of darkness and death at the end of history is real. And so I have this concluding statement. If origins are not based on a miracle of God, the present salvation is an illusion, and the future salvation offers no hope. And if any of you here are intrigued by the evidences of science and evolution and so forth, I have a high degree of respect for scientific inquiry. But this study here would show why so many people who believe the Bible have difficulty going down that road. For them is a dichotomy that is hard for them to hold together. The idea of a theistic evolution can be very appealing when you look at some of the arguments. But it does not seem to be where the Bible is taking us. It seems to be an accommodation to scientific evidence. So if the Bible for you is the final word, I think John would say, if origins are not based on a miracle of God, the present salvation is an illusion, and the future salvation offers no hope. Any final word? Question? Yes, and this will have to be final because we're already past 35. But short question and short answer.
Salvation, the present salvation is spiritual. The future salvation is physical. They are both real.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I use the word real attempting to communicate tangible. Yeah, could use a different word. Yes, it is real, but without that creative power, it doesn't change the world in the way that it could. It's my experience. Anyway, thank you and God bless.